Hey there. Thanks for tuning in to On the Health Record. I'm your host, Oleg Kujikov, and on this episode, I speak with the founder and CEO at WorkRamp, Ted Blosser. As far as guests go, Ted comes off just as smart and experienced as the rest of them, but he also had this can-do kind of energy that made recording the interview just really fun. I left feeling excited about the future of WorkRamp and all the possibilities that exist around modular learning. We start the interview by going over some of Ted's time as a student athlete in college. Then we talk about some of his work experience prior to starting WorkRamp. And finally, we wrap up with some of the lessons he's learned and challenges faced as a founder. This was a great learning episode for me, and I hope that you listening at home can take something out of it as well. If you enjoy this episode, please share it with a friend or reach out to us by emailing podcast@drchrono.com. And now, without further ado, let's go to the interview. My guest today was a product manager at Box before he left to start WorkRamp. WorkRamp is a learning management system used to educate employees and customers. We use it at DrChrono today to onboard new employees and educate existing ones. Ted Blosser, welcome to On the Health Record. Where does this podcast find you today?
Hey, Oleg. I'm in San Carlos today, California, just hanging out day before or a few hours before the elections.
Yeah. Thanks for joining me on election day. How are you doing today, I guess?
We're holding up. I feel like there's a lot of nervous energy in the world in general. But take it hour by hour here. We'll see.
Yeah. Well, we have a nice little hour here to take a break from the chaos and sort of just talk about some interesting topics. So thanks for joining me. Let's get into it. From looking at your LinkedIn profile, it's pretty easy to tell that you've been real busy for the last two decades. And I'm real excited to pick your brain today when it comes to working in product and entrepreneurship. But I want to start here. You were a student athlete at Santa Clara University. Can you tell us about being a student athlete in college and what your mindset was like back then?
Yeah, so I played tennis at Santa Clara. So I was actually one of the, I think, only walk-ons to Santa Clara University. I played competitively most of my young life and then walked onto the team, and then I played for 2 years. And I did that while doing electrical engineering. And it was definitely a challenge. I remember my grades were definitely slipping because you're putting in 20, 25 hours a week. You're traveling, you're missing labs while all of your friends are studying and going to all the extra learning sessions. But probably what it taught me is like, hey, how do you do time management while in college? You have the aspect of socializing while doing schoolwork, while doing sports is definitely a tough battle to juggle it all. But I think the biggest gains I got out of that is, hey, especially as a CEO now, is how do you juggle multiple things? How do you time manage correctly while you have almost a million things on your plate? But I want to trade that experience for the world. I'm glad I only did it 2 years. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't have graduated. So I spent the rest of that time basically getting my GPA back up and focusing on my studies.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I didn't know you had walked on. So you kind of like leaned into this student athlete lifestyle. It wasn't something that was kind of thrust upon you. That's definitely notable. But I want to ask about this. This might be kind of a blast from the past. I don't know if you remember this name, but can you tell me about the Roy T. Zapponi Award and what that means to you?
good research. So that's actually a funny award. So that was the Rookie of the Year Award. But technically, I was the only rookie on the team. So it was almost mine to lose. But they threw in like the team manager in there. I think someone in the back office. So it was actually me versus, I think, three other people just to make it a challenge. But yes, that was it was one of the few awards I won from the tennis team that year beyond carrying all the seniors and juniors bags while we were traveling. So that was definitely a good blast from the past. Good research.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, I kind of assumed you were competing against people that weren't exactly the team manager. But, you know, I'm sure you were a great tennis player and you had a promising college career ahead of you. What convinced you to walk away from playing sports in college after just 2 years?
Yeah, that's a great question. I remember sitting down with my dad in a cafe and thinking about it. I was playing basically competitively since I was six, right? And so you're essentially throwing away about 14 years, something you've been doing for about 14 years, and saying, hey, do I want to walk away from this? And for me is actually, I knew college was short. And now in my 30s, like, man, those 4 years are so critical. In those last 2 years, I knew I wanted to broaden my horizons. And so even in the startup world, it's time goes by so fast and you need to make sure you're trying new things. And for me, I was saying, hey, I want to actually do other things in college. I want to have friends that are outside the tennis team. I want to join a fraternity to see what that aspect of life is like. I want to try some extracurriculars on the engineering side. And so for us, is actually, for me, is more about experiences. And my dad sat me down. I remember that breakfast pretty vividly, where I said, hey, I think I'm going to quit tennis and try other things. He's like, hey, I think you should. You got 2 years left in this great four-year experience. You should do it. And it's actually the same mindset I have now of, even down to product development. It's like, hey, you got to try new things. You don't have that much time. And so it's really good to experiment and have these new experiences.
Yeah, that's a really interesting answer. I think this is going to be a theme. You seem like somebody who's able to kind of identify opportunities and take stock of, you know, how much time you have. But we'll get into that. Next, I want to talk about Box. And you were a product manager at Box.
Yep.
Was that your first job out of college?
That was not my first job out of college. I actually had two stints before that. One was at Cisco, right after school. I got recruited into essentially a mini MBA program out in Raleigh, North Carolina. So I was at Cisco for about 3.5 years. Then I had a stint of a failed startup that I founded called Stuffbox. And then when that startup failed, I said, hey, I have to go learn how to actually build a startup and go learn from the best. And that was when I started at Box from there.
Okay, got it. Can you tell me about getting hired at Box? And then, you know, you mentioned that you were trying to learn from the best. Did you know you wanted to go straight into product, or is that something you had to discover?
You know, I knew I was going to go back into product. It was really interesting when I was interviewing around right before I joined Box. I had a plethora of different opportunities I was chasing. I actually knew how to do iOS development, so I was chasing some iOS development jobs because that was really hot then. I was looking at a few PM jobs. I was looking at a few sales jobs, and the one I picked was the one that paid me the most, actually, because I basically depleted my savings. So I looked at a few of these offers and said, hey, look, I can do sales for now, get paid a boatload of money at the time for what I was making, which was zero. And I knew I could get that background, learn how to sell a SaaS product, because I'd only sold essentially tech hardware before. So that'd be a good entryway there. And I knew if I did that for a couple of years, it'd be a really great foundation. And I knew I would eventually head back into product. And so it was always with a short-term mindset, but I knew I wanted to go crush it for a couple of years and then move back into product.
And can you like paint the picture for me of what that team looked like at Box? You know, Box has a great product. So I imagine that their product team is like, you know, reflective of that. What did it actually look like?
Yeah. So at Box, product was definitely one of the top teams in the company. It was definitely a team that people aspire to join. You know, when you go into a lot of these different companies, the DNA of the company comes from typically the CEO or one of the co-founders, right? Mm-hmm. And Aaron was definitely a product guy at heart, even though he is pretty funny and vocal externally. He actually loves the product. That's where he spends most of his time. And you could see because he had basic product and design rolling up to him until the very end when he basically handed off the reins to other managers. Mm-hmm. But the team at that time had a very robust PM structure that spread across all the different product lines. And the team I joined was, I thought one of the most innovative parts of that team was the platform team. And that's actually where I got to meet the founders at DrChrono, was through our platform ecosystem. And what I liked about that team was that team actually owned some core parts of the product that they consider quote unquote platform, but it also, so you got some experience on the actual product itself, but it also got experience. You got some experience into the ecosystem, the APIs, the technical nitty gritty. And so I was really excited to kind of straddle both sides of the fence there, both the core product, but then also the technical, basically ecosystem side of the house as well.
And you mentioned, you know, you wanted to learn from the best. What were some of your key takeaways from being part of that product team?
Yeah, I would say when I say learn from the best, probably one of the coolest things I got to do was spend time watching Aaron do his magic. So Aaron Levy do his magic. So at that time, now there's so many cool startup CEOs, but at that time there weren't many cool startup CEOs like Aaron. And Aaron was really trailblazing the way. Box was really a force to be reckoned with by at that time. And when I got to work behind the scenes, I was like, wait, how's this sausage actually made? And I remember going to, because I had to participate in one of the big user conferences as a presenter. And I remember saying like, man, how did they do this? Like, where does Aaron come up with this stuff? Where does he come up with, all the way from his jokes to the partners that they bring on stage to getting celebrities like Jared Leto? How does this all work? And how does he come up with this positioning? I got to watch that all kind of behind the scenes and learn from how he did it. And so that was probably one of the biggest things I got to experience was seeing, hey, how did Aaron function at executive level? And then how did he flow that back into the day-to-day operations of the company? And that was really probably where I learned the most. Those last 2 years at Box when I was heavy into product management was probably my biggest growth time at the company. It's actually shaped and molded a lot of the thinking that I brought into WorkRamp as well.
Was there anything like unexpected you learned from Aaron?
You know, I think the biggest learning from Aaron was he knew what the market wanted and where you should position yourselves. And what I mean by that is he was like, you know, everyone now in COVID is talking about digital transformation. Like Benioff is talking about it. The ServiceNow CEO, McDermott's talking about it. Everybody talks about it. Aaron was talking about digital transformation back in 2013. And so he had this foresight where he knew exactly what messaging would resonate, even if he had built nothing around that specific area. And then he would mold and reframe his product to fit what customers wanted and what that messaging was. So I'll give you an even more tangible example. If you think about Box, it's really just file sharing, right? At the end of the day, you're sharing files. There's not anything extremely special about that. But then he would reframe that to say, hey, you as a business, your company runs on your files. That's your digital aspect of digital transformation. And in the next 5 to 10 years, the whole world's going to digitally transform. And so that's why you need a service like Box to be the foundation of that digital transformation. So if you think about that framing there, he took something as boring as dropping a file in an uploader to saying, hey, no, this is the crux of your entire revenue stream of your business is Box. And so it's just the way he would reframe the products he was selling to match what the industry and what customers wanted. And so and Benioff does that extremely well too. I would say the two of them are some of the best I've seen in terms of that reframing.
Interesting. And they weren't wrong. I mean, like the value of Box is huge. You know, next I would like to transition. I think it's a nice transition to actually delivering value to users. And
yeah,
this is something that comes up all the time today, especially in product circles. You know, Amazon focuses on customer delight. But you know, what does delivering value mean to you, and how have you done it in practice?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I had this founder tell me something really insightful. This was about 2 months ago. And he runs a pretty big business, about 200, 300 people. And he had this good point. He said, Ted, you know why companies pay Accenture $10 million and pay you whatever, $100,000, right?
Yeah.
It's because they know with that $10 million, they can buy the business outcome they want to buy. It's a really, really powerful statement. He was saying companies will spend $10 million with Accenture to say, hey, I want you to go deliver, let's call it faster time to market for our product team, right? That's the outcome they want to buy. And they're going to spend a $10 million check and guarantee that they're going to reduce that time by, let's say, 20%. And the ROI for them there on that 10 million is 100 million, right? So it's a $90 million ROI that they're getting, right? And what's really interesting, he said, Ted, if you can do that, that's what you need to do with software, especially in the enterprise space, is you need to guarantee your clients that you will drive the business outcomes they want to see. And so that's the value you should strive for, is especially in our space, and we do training software, is, hey, how are you going to deliver that business outcome and how are you going to make them see the ROI? So for us, a great example is you might buy us to reduce ramp time, right? Of your, let's say, of your sales team. So if you could reduce ramp time, even at like a DrChrono, by from 5 months to 4 months, right there, you're seeing a 20% reduction in ramp time, which might mean for one individual rep might mean $100,000 for you, right? And so that ROI for one rep can be easily quantifiable by the software you bring in. And so, so that's really how I think about the value you can deliver with your software is, hey, what are the outcomes you drive for your client? And then everything else comes after that, the features, the usability, the prettiness of the design. But if you could deliver the business outcome, the client will keep coming back to you.
Yeah. So your focus is on the outcome. That's really interesting and not really what I expected. But while we're on the topic of enterprise clients, you know, enterprise clients are not known for being easy to deal with or easy to satisfy.
Yep.
And yet you've worked at two companies that build really valuable solutions for enterprise customers.
Yes.
Can you speak to that?
Yeah. Just like you mean in terms of, what it's like to deliver value to enterprises or yeah. any other areas?
Well, yeah, like what it's like, and then how do you do it? You know, what are like the big challenges? Because, you know, frankly, you know, most of the listeners, you know, if you're listening from and you're working at DrChrono, you have enterprise clients.
But yep.
I imagine a lot of people listening don't deal with an enterprise on a daily basis. So
yeah.
What are some of the challenges that those enterprise customers present? And then how do you approach solving for those challenges? Because they're not problems that you want to make mistakes on.
I think the first thing you need to decide from a, let's call it from a founder standpoint, is what type of client do you want to serve? I remember I was talking to the Relate IQ founder and what your definition of enterprise is and know what your limit is. I remember talking to the Relate IQ founder and he was saying, hey, when we got focused on our business, this company exited to Salesforce for about $350 million. And he said, I knew my quote unquote enterprise client or enterprise SaaS client was 100 employees or less using Google Apps. And that was his client, right? Mm-hmm. But he's still building a pretty enterprise class solution for that client. And he even went down to the point where they have to be using Google Apps or I won't sell to them. And I think the big thing to know is like, what is your definition of enterprise? Like, what is your sweet spot that you want to focus on? And then make sure you build your product set and your value statements very strongly to that enterprise, that type of client. And so, for example, right now at WorkRamp, we really promote to mid-market and I would call it lower-end enterprise. We're not going after the Fortune 100s of the world, but we really know we're squarely in that specific space and we're building features around those clients. And then I think once you know what type of enterprise or enterprises you want to sell to, then you know, hey, what features and what challenges you should expect in the sales cycle and how you should benchmark yourself. So for example, if you're selling into the mid-market, you might want to say, hey, in the mid-market, I want to have a sub 60-day sales cycle. I want to have a sub 60-day implementation cycle. And I have an LTV of, let's say, 3 to 4 years to make the CAC or the customer acquisition costs pay off. Mm-hmm. And the reason I bring up this whole story is is if you know what you're getting into, then you want to mold your entire kind of company around that structure. And then if you ever want to change segments or change the types of clients you want to work with, then you start making moves on your internal team structure to support those type of clients. So it's kind of a long-winded way to answer your question of like, how do you deal with enterprises? And I think first and foremost, know what type of enterprises you want to deal with, and then kind of mold your business structure around those specific enterprises. And that's top down from the product features you're building all the way to how you market it to how you, the type of people you hire to support it.
Yeah. And one quick follow-up on that, like how did you narrow in on what kind of enterprise clients you were looking at? Was it kind of an iterative process where you looked back and said, you know, these customers, these clients worked out, these ones didn't, let's go after these? Or did you kind of, you know, envision what they would look like before setting out on that, you know, hunting trip for an elephant?
You know, it was really about what the market was telling us. So when you, so we went through YC, similar to DrChrono, and one of their mottos is make something people want. And we spent the first couple of years just kind of building, not really having a vision on who we want to serve. And the market basically pulled us into where we should be spending time. Like I'll give you a great example. We would, back in the day, sell to clients that didn't have somebody dedicated to training, but they would still buy your product. They would cut the check. And they would get really excited on day one, but come day 30, they're like, yeah, I'm on to my next priority, and no one's owning your product, right? And what we quickly realized is that the most successful clients were the ones that had a dedicated trainer or team of trainers, that they lived in your product day to day. They literally lived in it more than they lived in their CRM if you're a sales rep, or your HR system if you're an HR. And there was a strong, strong product market fit because they're using your product so much, and your product is a critical part of their role. And so I think that's the big thing to know is like, hey, you have to be very honest with yourself of where the market is pulling you. Look at the signals, and then shed the clients or act on the signals that you're seeing, and make sure you just keep honing in on the clients that just are fanatical about your product. And that's kind of what we've done over time. And that's why when I said, hey, we're mostly on mid-market and enterprises, the SMB, those are fine, but there's some players in that space that want to do that. But for us, we'd rather make sure that our clients who have dedicated team members on our product using it day-to-day are the types of clients we're serving.
So next, I want to ask about starting a company. In 2015, Box had just gone public and you were working there. Why did you decide to start a company at that point? And you know, what was the core of the issue that you were trying to solve?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So right in 2015, I actually just had our first daughter. This is almost like first child crisis, if that's a term.
Oh my God. Huge year for you.
Yeah. So it was actually the late 2014 she was born, but 2015 was the diaper changing phase.
Okay.
And and you just started coming out of the cloud of not sleeping for a couple months.
Oh my God. Yeah.
And for me personally, I think that was the kind of kick in the butt to say, hey, if you want to do this, you should do this now. Like you're in your early 30s. I think I just turned 30 at the time. And there's probably not a better time to do this than now. It's you probably don't want to wait till your 40s or 50s to go start your company for the first time. And so that was the first impetus. It was more like, all right, I need to get this in gear if I want to go do it. And I think it's a great, great time to start. And then once I got into that mindset, then I was basically 100% on board. Then it was about what market that I want to go into, what was I passionate about, what problems that I want to solve. And it's kind of interesting. It wasn't like earlier in my life, I was saying, hey, let's go solve this learning problem. It was a peripheral problem I kind of observed, but it wasn't something I said, hey, in 2006, when I graduated college, I need to go solve the learning market. Kind of like with Aaron kind of stumbled into the file sharing market, right? And so for us, I started to look at that as one of the couple problems that I thought were really big in the enterprise space. And my criteria was pretty simple, was, hey, what's a big pain point? What has a huge TAM, right? And what is a market that I'm pretty equipped to basically service, like with my background? And so when we looked at the learning market, it basically checked all those points. Like, big pain point was, hey, all the learning software really sucked and it still sucks today, right? The TAM is gigantic. It's $270 billion per year spent on corporate training. And then there aren't many people that have like a sales and product background in enterprise SaaS that want to go start a company in Silicon Valley in the learning space. And so I was pretty well equipped to do that. I think with those three things, it gave me the confidence to say, hey, let's go do this. I recruited one of my good friends and now co-founder, Arsh, who worked early at Box as well. And then we just started cranking and we just built the product from there.
Incredible. You know, Ted, I talked to a lot of, not a whole lot, but, you know, quite a few CEO founders and entrepreneurs. And I would say most of the time, like 90% of the time, it's people find a problem that infuriates them. And then they go and figure out how to be a founder slash CEO. And it seems like you've kind of done the opposite. That's real interesting. Do you think that set you up for the success you've had so far?
Yeah, it's kind of interesting when you put it that way. I would say yes, because you basically take an objective approach to the problem. And I think the other problem of like people kind of scratching their own itch only, it's like, hey, that's the itch that was hot at that moment. It might not be that hot in 2 years from now. And that's where you see a lot of kind of founders fail. It's like, yeah, they weren't that passionate about the space. I'm sure there's probably a lot of founders in the kind of Deadpool region where they're saying, you know what, I was passionate about that, but I wasn't that passionate about it. Mm-hmm. And I think for us, when you take that objective approach, almost like a consultant saying, hey, here are the facts, here's what needs to be solved. I'm not necessarily only doing this because I'm tied emotionally to it. I'm actually doing this because I'm taking a very objective look at the market. It gives you a good perspective to say, yeah, I think I can solve this. And I remember listening to a podcast from Todd McKinnon, the founder of Okta. Mm-hmm. And Okta, what is now a $30 billion, $40 billion market cap company. Mm-hmm. And Okta, the first iteration of it was actually totally different. It was actually around network, basically having a view into the status of all of your different cloud applications from a network management standpoint. So like, hey, what's up, what's down, what's the health of all the different cloud apps you have? And then he basically pivoted into this cloud identity idea after he had started. And I think it's because he noticed, hey, objectively looking at that market, I actually think this identity problem and the security around identity is a much bigger market than just this kind of network management piece of this. And he was able to objectively look at it and shift gears and turn it into a gigantic, gigantic company.
Okay, so you've mentioned a few times Y Combinator. Can you tell us the story about your relationship with DrChrono and Y Combinator?
Yeah, that's a great story. So, you know, I knew Daniel and Michael through the Box ecosystem. We had them up on stage during one of the keynotes with Aaron, and I got to meet them behind the scenes. And what was great is when we started WorkRamp, both Daniel and Michael gave us a ton of advice on how to apply to YC, how to start the company, how to get some of our first customers. And I remember asking Daniel to be one of our first customers. I said, hey, do you want to test this out? And Lindsay was, I think, in the room there too. Mm-hmm. He was like, yeah, sure, why not? As long as it's not too expensive, I'll definitely test it out. And they were one of the first customers. And what was also really funny is they gave us a nice recommendation into YC. And I remember maybe a couple months after them testing out the product, I said, hey, Daniel, you okay just paying me a little bit for this product? He said, hey, as long as it's not too much, as long as you don't jack my price up when you become big and successful. So I said, hey, how about like $50 a month? We'll just put it on a credit card. And he's like, sure, let's do it. And I didn't even have, I think, a way to accept credit cards. We hacked something together off like a Jot form and put Stripe behind that. and yeah. Daniel and Lindsay swiped their credit card. And what was really great about that is then we went for the interviews at YC and we were interviewing. And I remember Jessica Livingston was interviewing us. I think it was one of her last kind of batches of interviews she did before they moved to London. And she was interviewing us and she said, "Oh, DrChrono is a customer, are they?" And I was like, yeah, they're a customer. And then I told them about how they're using us. And she said, "Well, are they paying you?" And because that was their kind of source of truth of like, hey, is this a real solution or are they just kind of fake using the product? And I said, you know what? They are paying us now. I didn't tell them how much. Yeah. And what was really cool is in real time, Jessica emailed or Google chatted Michael, I believe, and said, "Hey, Michael and Daniel, I believe," and said, "Hey, are you guys using WorkRamp? And also, are you paying them?" And she knew they're very frugal at the time, and they said yes and yes, and I would recruit them. And I think that was one of the big reasons we got in into the program is because we actually asked them to pay us just a little bit of money, and we got very good vouching from them as well. So thank you, Daniel and Michael.
Awesome. Yeah. Wow. So many thoughts. You know, if you're good at something, never do it for free. And this is kind of the story that proves that lesson.
Yep, exactly.
Can you tell me what your most exciting moment so far has been as a CEO? You know, I'm sure you've had plenty. Is there one that stands out?
Oh, man, there's so many. I would say there's so many in every different phase of the business. I'll give you a good one is just starting out. I remember when we got our first significant paying client. So that was $5K a month. So it wasn't just a $50, $5K a year. So it wasn't just a $50 per month client. So it was a $5K client. And I remember we were basically living off savings, trying to make this work. And I remember opening up the mailbox and seeing this $5,000 check in our mailbox. And we didn't even have a bank account at that time. I don't even think we had incorporated officially yet. And so that was just such an exciting moment where especially in the software world and the SaaS world, you're like, man, I'm exchanging online value and actually getting this physical check in return that could run over to the bank. And I remember right away, we filed all that paperwork to incorporate and we opened up the bank account. I was just so proud walking to the teller and saying, "Hey, I want to deposit this $5,000 check into the business." And it was really interesting. I think once you receive that check, and when you're working at other companies, you think that stuff is all automatic. It's on the back end. You never see it. Like boxes processing millions and millions a day, right, of checks like that. But when you see it tangibly, it's just you're in awe of it now. And just saying like, "Hey, I'm actually providing back to the business outcomes we mentioned earlier. We're actually providing an outcome to clients through online software and they're going to pay you money for it." That was probably one of the most exciting portions of starting the company. And then obviously in all the other phases, I would say there's other fun stories like that, but from the early days, that was one of the most exciting.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. I mean, that's kind of like a proof of concept for you right there. Once you start getting paid for the work.
Yes.
That's always an exciting moment. So you took me to the top of the mountain. Now let's go to the bottom of the valley. What was your biggest moment of despair as a founder / CEO?
Oh, I actually remember this vividly. So I remember very early on. So this is kind of back in the DrChrono coming on board, getting this $5,000 check. We were, and I do encourage this to a lot of startup founders, we were experimenting with the market. We were looking for product market fit. And this is within the first couple months of the business. And we had a very large tech company on the engineering side testing out our platform. And at that time, I didn't know who to sell to. I would sell to someone's mom or brother or cousin. Anybody went to buy our software, I would sell it to. Yeah. And I remember this big tech company was testing it out, using it. They were using this pilot. I was like driving up to San Francisco every day from San Carlos and meeting with this buyer. and I was bragging about them to potential future investors. And then after a good 2 months, just something never really felt right though, as a great name brand. This buyer emailed me and said, "Hey, Ted, I appreciate all the effort, but I don't think I'm going to move forward with this." And I remember getting that email and I remember walking into our master bedroom and just shutting off the lights. It's the middle of the day, shutting off the lights and just laying on the bed in silence. And not in tears so much, but just saying like, man, is this ever going to work? Right. Mm-hmm. And I kind of was in self-pity for about an hour. And then I got out of that bed, opened the blinds. And you know what? I was like, you know what? That was okay. That was probably not the best use case. I probably knew it in my kind of heart of hearts. Mm-hmm. And I'm so glad that happened because it showed me, hey, you shouldn't force kind of a square peg in a round hole, even though it's a great name brand. And if we had gone down that road earlier on and serviced that use case, we would have been in a different spot now, if any spot. And it's one of those things where I'm so glad we actually lost that client, because if we had to still support them in that kind of odd use case, WorkRamp probably wouldn't have got to where it was now. It could have taken us totally off trajectory. And it's one of those things where in the kind of micro evaluation of it, you think the world has ended, like I was laying on the bed. But then now when you look back on it, it's probably the best thing that could have happened to the company is losing that client, even though it was really, really harmful in the beginning.
Yeah, that's an awesome story. Hard to believe. And I like how, it's hard to believe when you're in the moment that things will get better. But, you know, the failure is never the end of the story. And clearly, you're the example of that. Shifting to COVID, how was WorkRamp uniquely positioned to take off before COVID-19 hit?
Yeah, so before COVID-19 hit, we were doing really well. We still did really well through COVID. I want to say as good as like a Zoom, but still doing really well. We were seeing 3 to 4x of for example, MAUs during that COVID time. And so everyone had to train more because they were remote. And if you listen to pretty much all the big tech CEOs, and this is kind of back to the original part of the conversation around digital transformation, is that everyone basically condensed 5 to 10 years of their digital transformation plays into literally a 3 to 6 month window because they had to,
yeah.
Right? Yep. And what was really cool is that we were a big beneficiary of that because you need to move people to work from home. You need to train them on how to work from home. You need to push policies and procedures to those people and verify that they were being adhered to. And there's just a lot more learning and training and process enhancements going on. And training has been a big kind of cornerstone and foundation to that. And you'll see that in the market. That's why there's so much funding for e-learning solutions, LMS solutions as of late, because that's going to be a big investment area here over the next couple of years as basically digital transformation has accelerated. So I would say for us, we were luckily a good beneficiary of this. And then I think the next thing people will be figuring out is, hey, as we start easing out of COVID, how do you continue delivering value when you move into like a hybrid remote world? What's that customer base going to look like? How are you going to continue accelerating growth? Because there are some companies that just directly benefited from COVID. And I think when you come out of COVID and the pandemic, they'll have to again reinvent their model to make sure they can maintain that growth because they don't want to slow that growth down just because they're moving out of the pandemic.
Are you doing anything today at WorkRamp in response to COVID that you think has worked really well? And kind of what I'm imagining here in my head is like, are you using WorkRamp at WorkRamp to do more onboarding, to get people trained, to sort of hit the ground running and do their work?
Yeah, so we do. So the dog, we call it drink our own champagne because no one internally liked it when I called it eating your own dog food.
Oh my God.
But it's a big part of our day-to-day too. Mm-hmm. when you think about just the onboarding use case, because now we've now onboarded a ton of people fully remote. So we spent a lot of time making sure the onboarding structure is really sound. So for example, we have a very structured 4-week remote onboarding program that's a hybrid of essentially instructor-led trainings with some on-demand trainings. And then we culminate each week with a big milestone in our product called Challenges, which is basically, hey, you need to go stand and deliver a pitch, or you need to stand and deliver sample QBR if you're on the customer success team. And we have those kind of culmination points each week, and you basically test out of them until you're fully ramped up. And so we do a ton of that on the onboarding side, especially during COVID here. Mm-hmm. And then on the training side, we've been heavily focused on micro training. And so we will do quick bite-sized trainings that are sub 30 minutes on specific topics. And so, for example, we will do a big rollout that on Salesforce, a big enhancement we did in Salesforce to the whole go-to-market team in a 30-minute session using our micro training modules. And so we found that's been super helpful just for us to basically drink our own champagne mm-hmm. and basically accelerate how we're doing business, both from an onboarding and ongoing training perspective too.
That's interesting. Did you start doing the challenges in response to COVID, or was that something you had in place beforehand?
We had it in place, but we've now made them more robust. I would say we spend even more time now making sure those onboarding programs are super efficient and extensive too. So I would say we probably, because of COVID, we probably upped our game by 25-30% in terms of the types of content and how we were doing this. Before that 25-30%, we were kind of making it up by doing hallway conversations, letting people shadow in person, those type of things. But now that's all digital, we had to really up our game on the investment into making really good onboarding paths and training paths. And challenges is one of our advanced features to really make sure people are understanding the materials through basically live interaction and live training.
Yeah, well, it seems like a great way to keep people engaged. So let's keep talking about kind of ramping up a remote workforce.
Yeah.
Can you speak about knowledge churn, and is this a problem? Well, let's start with that. Can you speak about knowledge churn? What is knowledge churn?
Yeah. So you mean knowledge churn from employee, like an employee leaving or moving roles, that type of knowledge churn, or just employee forgetting something?
No. Yeah. The first one. Yeah. Kind of the knowledge churn that startups experience.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a great question. So I'm actually reading this book that some of my customers recommended about how people learn.
I've heard of it. Yeah.
Yeah, and it talks a lot about how you learn through storytelling, not so much about dumping facts on people. But back to your point on knowledge churn, we have a heavy emphasis on documenting and sharing knowledge, both within our knowledge sharing application, so that's Confluence, we call that Command Center internally,
okay,
and also WorkRamp too. So we give this analogy where if you're in a university system, the book is like your Confluence or knowledge center, and then the class and the instructor and the tests are like your learning management system, which is WorkRamp. And so in terms of that knowledge churn, is we tell everyone, and we do reminders on in every single role, is anytime you have anything major, make sure you document it and get that process out. And so we spend extra time documenting pretty much every major process. And we make it so that, hey, if you get hit by a bus, someone else can come in and take over by just reading through the docs. And or reading through the training. And so we'll do that, whether that's competitor training or whether that is documentation on a feature that we've built or just a process on the IT side, we'll make sure we get that documented squared away so that if that person left that role, that documentation is there for that next person to pick up and learn. And so I think that's super critical in these fast growth environments, because we've all seen the stats that The average tenure, especially in Silicon Valley, is sub 2 years. And so think about that. You have 8 quarters per person. You're probably spending 1 quarter onboarding them, probably 1 quarter where they're checked out offboarding. And you really just have about 6 solid quarters of them being productive in the business, right? And so you need to make sure they ramp up as quickly as possible and are really effective during those 6 quarters, right? And you do that by having really good training that's super high leverage and having really good knowledge retention by having those having that knowledge documented.
And then what are some of the consequences of not addressing that knowledge churn, in the long term?
Yeah, if you're not addressing that, you're essentially losing time and losing the IP that the company is gaining, right? Mm. So I remember I read Ray Dalio's book, Principles. Mm. And, you know, it's a really long, somewhat boring book, but it has a lot of good tidbits in there. Right. But he essentially writes plays and rules for everything he's learned, and he distributes this to the company so that you continue compounding your knowledge and your learning. And he just has this mindset that a business is almost like a living organism that makes a ton of mistakes and learns a ton, and then you basically have to document these learnings so the next people that come up can learn from that and not make those mistakes again. And the organization evolves and grows because of that compounding knowledge. And so if you're a company that's not allowing that knowledge to compound, you just won't compound. You'll just grow at a smaller rate, right? And you'll make the same mistakes over and over again. Mm-hmm. And so I take that mindset into account of saying, hey, like one of our big cultural values is always be improving, which is, hey, you can make mistakes, but help people learn from those, including yourself, and get better that next time, right? And so it's a big cultural value for us. And so if you're not documenting that knowledge and those mistakes, you're going to severely hamper the growth of your organization. I think that's the biggest thing.
Yeah, well said. Okay, next, let's talk about onboarding. Can you tell me what the most common challenges are when it comes to onboarding? You mentioned earlier that, you know, a lot of the LMS software out there sucks. I would say WorkRamp doesn't, but yeah, can you speak to like the common challenges you see in onboarding?
Yeah, so onboarding, so you have a spectrum, right? You have some companies that do a really bad job with it, which don't do it at all. They just say, hey, here's your laptop, good luck, right? And you have some companies that might overdo it or might not even get you into the environment as fast as you could. Mm-hmm. I would say the biggest thing about onboarding is making sure you have the process in place first and foremost, right? And then iterating on it. And so what I mean by that is when I talked about that 4-week process, those 4 weeks, probably every start class we have, I change those 4 weeks around. So before we had those 4 weeks, we had basically a 2-week process in that system wasn't that good. So we said, hey, let's go to a 4-week process. So you want to make sure you at least have a structured, logical approach to, hey, what belongs in your onboarding? So for us, it's a solid 4 weeks. Mm-hmm. But then from there is asking every single start class, hey, what could we have done to improve or what would you have done to make this easier for you? And literally every start class, I will switch sessions around, switch topics around. I would switch the order of things. So for example, week one, you might just do a market introduction. And then week two, then do the product introduction. And I remember hearing on the sales team, they prefer doing the product introduction first and then doing the market introduction after that. So there's a big switch we made to say, hey, actually, let's get you very comfortable with the product first. And then we'll dive into the more generalities of the space itself. And so I think those are the two big things that companies fall into. First is just make sure you have something in place that's pretty robust and thought out. So that's the process piece. Mm-hmm. And then two is constantly iterate on it. And because your market's going to change, your users are going to say, hey, this works better if you do this first versus this. And so you want to make sure you constantly iterate on it, literally almost with every single cohort.
And then can you speak to kind of the value that having a good onboarding process provides both to kind of the students during the onboarding, and then the users who are kind of administering the lessons?
Yeah.
What are they gaining? Like, yeah. What do they gain from a really robust onboarding process?
Yeah, I would say for the students, and my wife's just onboarding into a new job today. She worked somewhere else for about 12 years, and she's just onboarding for the first time. And this, mm-hmm. It's a big tech conglomerate, and she's loving it, right? They have a very well thought out, it's almost like, she's like, this is like a nation state, and they have everything so well thought out on the onboarding process. But that first impression or that foundation will set you up for success for the whole time that employee is at the company.
Yeah.
And so you want to think of that as probably the most impactful 4 weeks that that person will have, literally for the whole time they're there. And think about kind of back to compounding effects, is if that goes well, everything else will go well. So and do even better if you have a good onboarding program. So when we talked about kind of those 8 quarters of success, if you could knock out that first quarter really well, those next 6 or 7 quarters while that employee is with you, is you're going to get way better returns than if that first quarter went poorly. So I think that's the biggest thing from a learner perspective, or what we call a learner perspective, an end user perspective, is that will set them up for success for the rest of the time at the company. So you should think through that. And then from a business perspective, is if you do this well, that's when you're going to see those outcomes we talked about earlier. So if you do a very good onboarding program, you're going to see a reduced time to basically efficiency for that employee, which is going to drive up your growth numbers. And so if you ramp someone up more quickly on the sales side, you're going to see higher revenue. If you ramp somebody up more quickly on the engineering side, you're going to see more features delivered while they're there. And so it's probably the highest leverage point you have with your employees, is making sure that onboarding program goes well.
Yep. You only get one chance to make a first impression.
Yep, exactly.
Okay, next, can you tell me what some of your power features are at WorkRamp? That's kind of an industry term I should have asked beforehand. I don't know if you believe in it, but do you believe in power features, and what are they at WorkRamp?
Ooh, that's a great question. I'll answer this in a slightly different way. I would say themes, power themes that we use. Because in our space, in the learning space, the thing about our segment is it's very feature rich, just like with DrChrono, EHRs are very feature rich, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so you're never really going to have like this feature better than that next feature, because there's so many, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But I would say the themes that we focus on are twofold. One is just amazing learner experience. And so do you ride Peloton by chance, Oleg?
I do not. I fancy myself someday riding Peloton.
Okay, cool. But if you ever ride it, it's like you will see that end user experience is just amazing. Like it's all built around this end user experience that blew away what in-home cycling was like in the past, right? No, everyone gave up on the industry. They're like, you're never going to make a bike that people like. And they and they did it by just creating this amazing user experience. I remember the first time I did it, I was like, oh my gosh, I get it now. It felt like using the iPhone for the first time. It felt like you leapt 10 years in the future from a exercise standpoint when you try it for the first time. So that's the type of experience we want to give, not just now, but also in the long term, is just literally the best learner experience that the market's never seen. Because our market, traditionally, no one has ever liked the learner experience. So just like Peloton disrupted the in-home cycling industry, we want to disrupt how corporations think about that learner experience. And then on the admin side, the big theme there is, hey, how do you make this so you don't have to be a whiz to get content up and running, to get the account up and running, to basically administer training? You don't have to be as good as a administrator, as like a Salesforce administrator, but you can go learn this in the matter of minutes and be very effective in using the admin console, yet still have a lot of power features that, let's say, a more a more mature administrator might want. And so we learned that at Box, actually. So Box was known for its simplicity over its old competitors, like the Documentums of the world. Mm-hmm. But then what they did was on the admin side, they still stuffed a ton of enterprise features, but still made the end user experience great on the admin side. So it's powerful, yet very easy to deploy and administer. So that's really our kind of ethos on the admin side as well.
Yeah, that's really interesting that, you know, you have a lot of features, so you kind of approach it bigger than just power features. You know, you're thinking of it from a themes perspective.
That's, yeah, exactly.
That's really interesting. And I think that's going to be pretty useful at DrChrono.
Yes.
So thank you. Okay, last question here. Ted, first off, thanks. This interview has been great. You know, I've learned so much speaking to you. You have, you know, done so much at your age, and it's been a pleasure. You seem like a guy who gets a lot done and has it all together. So I want to know, what inspires you? Do you have a person or another company that sort of you model yourself after? How would you answer that?
Yeah, you know, I do. It's funny. I tell my wife I only read nonfiction business books. That's the only thing I read, especially when I was driving. When I was driving a ton back before COVID, I was listening to business books on tape pretty much every single commute.
Audible?
Audible. Yes, yes. Yeah. So I would crush through like a book a week, right? Or listen to really good business podcasts. So I'm kind of a junkie on kind of business literature in general, outside of my standard Netflix binging that I do. So I would say probably I do admire a lot of different executives. Probably the one I've recently admired was basically Bob Iger from Disney. So I read Ride of a Lifetime. This is about a year ago. This is on a trip up to actually Sonoma with the family, and I was listening to it. And what I loved about him was he took such a humble approach to being a CEO, and he had just such a clear strategy of what he wanted to get done at Disney. And we actually modeled during our all hands kickoff for 2020 before COVID. We modeled basically our themes of the business around how he did that at Disney. So he had this very clear vision at Disney of basically three things that he wanted to get accomplished. It was basically become more international, which was integrating with countries like China. So he opened up Disney China. Another one was move digital. He was able to basically move and create Disney Plus, basically from thin air, and then essentially focus on the content. And so he acquired a ton of companies during his tenure, like Marvel and Lucas. And that those were his three tenets. He used those three tenets for his whole time as CEO there. And it made Disney the powerhouse that it is. And so for me, I strive to be humble, but also have very, very clear direction with the team and get everyone flowing in the same direction. And just like Bob, I started this year with three key messages to the team. And we said, hey, we're going to go conquer these three things this year. And then and every quarter, we've just come back to those three things. Even with COVID, they were still really relevant. And then we got everybody kind of rowing in the same direction on those three things. And that's probably who I've admired the most, especially with his approach and also his strategy. And it's too bad he retired this year. It was so sad to see that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he's left the company in a great position moving forward.
Yes. Yes. Minus the theme parks being closed, but not his fault.
Right. Not his fault at all. Awesome. Well, thank you, Ted. This conversation has been thoughtful, insightful. So thanks for joining the podcast.
No problem. Thanks for having me.